Thank you, Prem Kumar ji. I hope everybody has switched off the mic. At the outset, I have to thank Dr. Guleria. I have to thank Dr. Chatterjee for having spared their time for this noble cause. And I have to compliment Dr. Chhatrapati, Sanjeev Mathur, and the entire team for having organized this timely session. Much has already been discussed. Actually, speaking from a medical point of view, I was the other day also telling Dr. Guleria, what has happened is that all this seems very new to us, and we are taken aback, including the medical fraternity, because we had forgotten observing these norms for the last 20, 30 years, even in the medical parlance. Because even the medical fraternity was by and large occupied by the management of non-communicable disease, whether it is diabetes, it is heart attack, it is cancers, it is because people started living long. Please switch off.
Arun?
So, because the infectious diseases, communicable diseases, these diseases had been by and large conquered. I think some. Please switch off the mic. See, the disadvantage or advantage of speaking from respective homes is that your children also, your grandchildren are at the back of most of the senior citizens. So that's a good sign. You are with your family. But for a moment, if we could switch off. So what I was saying is that in the last 20, 30 years, even the medical fraternity had got used to the treatment of these non-communicable diseases, because these communicable diseases like dysentery, cholera, typhoid, by and large, got conquered because of the advent of the effective antibiotics, antimicrobials. Otherwise, till about 50s or even 1960s, what is being discussed in the last 1 hour or so was a normal practice even in clinical medicine. When I, for example, came newly into this profession, we had diseases like tuberculosis. The streptomycin, which is the first drug for tuberculosis, came in the early 1950s. Penicillin came in late 1940s. And for tuberculosis, you had sanatorium concept. You had one size, and some of the world's best sanatoriums in India, because tuberculosis was known to happen in India, not in the West. And one of the best sanatoriums which still exists is at a place called Tambaram, which is close to Chennai, just next to the Meerambakkam Airport. And all these things were practiced. As Dr. Guleria was referring, after a patient got discharged, his mattresses, his bed sheets would be kept in the sunlight for natural disinfection. Hand washing was a norm. Now, what happened in the last 20, 30 years, while the medical fraternity also got preoccupied with the treatment of other diseases, the society also got used to have bowel wash and wiping of hands. The other day, because I belong to an old school of thought, so about 2 years back, I was at a five-star hotel, and I have the bad or good habit of washing hands after the meal. They couldn't arrange a hand wash because they had no such arrangement. It's obsolete. So then they were kind enough to make me walk to the entrance lounge. So what I'm trying to say that what these measures are being now told to us are actually inherent to our, not only our culture, but also to our clinical medicine which we practice, because this was a country known for tropical diseases. Tropical diseases like plague. We had epidemics one after the other. We had the cholera epidemic just before independence, after the Bengal famine, which gave rise to oral rehydration solution, which later became electrolyte solution. That time it was called Dhaka mixture. Dr. Chatterjee is actually relatively younger, so he may not, but the older people would recall, among the medical fraternity also, it was known as Dhaka mixture because it came in. There were so many patients suffering from dehydration and gastroenteritis, there was not enough of water, so they would have tub of water, put salt, soda, and boiled water. And then you had an epidemic of plague. You had tuberculosis, a continuous epidemic. Malaria again and again. That is why America is now looking towards India, because chloroquine was like, you know, taking a pill every day in India. So what I am saying is that we have now actually gone back to the earlier rules of clinical practice, which were inherent to us. In a way, it is going to help us otherwise also, not only for corona, but even other. One important thing as far as the corona discussion was concerned, I think somehow the discussion didn't come up, was that in the last 2-3 weeks, the data that we have received reveals that the mortality is higher among the elders, the morbidity is higher among the youngers. I don't know whether, I'll try to explain it. Of course, Dr. Chatterjee would understand it, because this is how you put it in the clinical physiology. Mortality means the death. So more number of deaths have happened in plus 60. Morbidity is debilitation on account of disease. So much more of effect of disease has happened in the younger. So about 60 to 70% of the people who became sick with COVID-19 are in the younger age group of 30 to 40. But they did not die, for reasons that we have discussed, because they have a high immunity status. But they are getting it at a higher level, because in the initial days of lockout, or even pre-lockout phase, the norms were not so strictly observed or not taken so seriously. So they had a high level of confidence that we can't do anything. They were loitering around. Now they have become cautious. But they carried home, and the elders were not moving out. But they carried home, and elders, as was being talked by Dr. Chatterjee, since they had a lesser immune status, when they got infected, they were at the risk of mortality. So more number of deaths, if you see in the last 3 weeks, have happened in plus 60, although more number of cases of COVID-19. So that is one phenomena which we have to understand and guard against, both as medical clinicians as well as the opinion makers and also common citizens. So that also applies to what Dr. Guleria was rightly putting it. Children can go out and they will not get it. But they will, and they may remain asymptomatic, even though carriers. But they may go home and affect the grandparents. So that is the risk that we have to guard against. So that is why the entire family again and again is being retreated, that you stay indoors, observe the normal distancing, etc. About the mass, I think Dr. Chatterjee has very nicely explained. The idea is to not to have the droplet contact. Now what is happening is that as the population has increased, there is crowding everywhere, and for people like me, I was telling the other day, when we are in public life, everyone wants to come and say something in your ear. So we don't know how many people are spitting on us. And the compulsion of being in electoral politics is that if you keep them away, you lose a vote. So these things are actually basically part of our civilized habit, which sometimes we have to compromise for a variety of reasons. So the idea is to avoid somebody throwing his spit on you or throwing his droplet on you. And therefore, you need not necessarily have N95, which could be reserved for the doctors and others. Even a common cloth would be sufficient. That is why we are now encouraging more and more of homemade masks. And I'm glad to note and put on record that Northeast has taken a lead. We have large number of self-help groups, particularly among young women, who are making homemade masks. About overall washing hands, of course, the hygiene is important even otherwise. See, even today, the point that we miss is that even if you take today's, the number of deaths that would have happened in India in the last 24 hours. That means from 12 o'clock midnight 8 to 12 o'clock midnight 9. The number of deaths would have happened more on account of non-COVID reasons than COVID. Which means that if you have to observe hygiene, it has to be observed not only to prevent COVID, but also prevent you from compromising your immunity. Like, for example, in some of the quarantine stations, I intervened and I asked them to maintain a good hygienic washroom or toilet, because otherwise what would happen if you are 10 people using a single toilet, the person would go there, he may not get COVID, he may get dysentery from there, he may get gastroenteritis, he may get typhoid. So in the process of preventing COVID, you succumb to some other disease. And then if you are an elder citizen, this is the group that we are discussing today, if you get typhoid, if you get dysentery, or if you get some other disease, your immunity in the process would inadvertently get compromised and make you more vulnerable to COVID also. So it's a vicious cycle. So that is the importance underlying maintenance of hygiene by all means. And that is why the social distancing part. And before I conclude, I just have to suggest, the government has launched an app called Arogya Setu, particularly for the medical professionals and police personals. We have asked them to download it, but for all of us, because it has an inherent processing programming which enables it to guard us against the presence of a corona positive person around, or a possibility risk around. So whatever be the benefit, as long as it helps, I think it's not difficult. Anybody can access it through our mobile. It's called Arogya Setu, and of course before I conclude, I have to also salute and acknowledge the service rendered by the medical fraternity, the police personnel, whom we have started calling Corona Warriors. You cannot imagine, it's very difficult to imagine, because incidentally I am dealing with both the circles. Most of the doctors who are appearing on the television are my age group, but you cannot imagine how tediously, with what kind of hardship our youngsters are giving duties, the residents in the age group of late 20s, 30s. Day before yesterday, I came across a young girl, a resident, who was telling me that she was going for a duty and trying to give a duty for 8 hours at a stretch, because we were a little short of these PPE kits, the protective gowns. Now, of course, we have started receiving it in abundance, and we started manufacturing within India also. So as Prime Minister said, this is one opportunity which has retreated our Make in India resolve. So now the kits are available in sufficient numbers, but earlier they were not. So this girl was giving an 8-hour duty simply because if she gave a shorter shift, then she would not get the protective equipment. And in that 8-hour, this poor girl would avoid going to the washroom also, because then you have it's mandatory to change the kit. She would not have any meal also, because again, you are the guideline says, SOP says, you have to change the PPE gown. And I felt so much for her when she told me that before going for duty, for 1 hour prior to that, she was not consuming anything, eating or drinking, so that she could avoid going to the washroom for the next 8 hours. So I think the hardship and with the difficulty with which our young residents who are giving duty day and night is something which has actually reflected the kind of health care capacity that India has. And of course, as far as the pensioners are concerned, I think Sanjeev Mathur would also convey to them later on. Otherwise, also most of the pensions have been disbursed in time. And in case there are any such cases where there's difficulty, they must intimate the department so that they can come to their help. And as I said, since you are the opinion makers, I hope you will go home and tell people that there's no dearth of supplies. The supplies of eatables, food is adequately being taken care of, because many of you go for the morning walk, and then, you know, there are a lot of apprehensions because of the misinformation also. So you can help us as our messengers. In fact, in some of the peripheral areas like Northeast, Jammu Kashmir, Ladakh and island territories, air cargo facility has been made on a priority. Northeast already has now started receiving, it's already received about 90 to 100 tons of air cargo supplies. Jammu Kashmir, initially Jammu received one, Ladakh is receiving regularly depending on requirement, and the island territories. And before I conclude and thank you all, I'm sure if we have the extension of this lockout period, then depending upon the inputs and depending upon the need, we could also repeat this session. And next time, if we have the opportunity to repeat it, we would decide the theme depending upon the suggestion given by our senior citizens, because they are all senior officers, many of them much more experienced than us. So we will give them the opportunity and privilege to decide what should be the theme of our next video conferencing, and accordingly, so that we are here to facilitate and to make life more productive and useful for this huge section of citizens of India. I once again thank you very much, and I'm sure next time when we meet, we would also be more accustomed to this video conferencing meeting. Thank you very much.
Sir, before we conclude,